I'm gonna hit him now.
Hey, why'd you?
What's up, you guys? Welcome back to Southern Draw Law. My name is James White, criminal defense attorney, former prosecutor, former police officer. Today's video comes to us from Medina County, Texas, and it depicts an arrest where a 17-year-old boy, he was taken into custody really without incident after a felony traffic stop by then Medina County Deputy Jonathan Nunemaker. Now, the arrest itself was pretty uneventful, other than a felony traffic stop, which is where he's ordered out of the vehicle with guns, and that's where the officer's, you know, giving you verbal commands, turn off the vehicle, face away from me, get down on your knees, cross your legs, put your hands behind your head, that kind of stuff. That's a standard felony traffic stop. That was uneventful as far as to actually taking him into custody. But the video we're about to see comes to us from KSAT 12, which is a local news station that covers the Medina County, Texas area, and they're going to explain exactly what happened in this case, so let's give it a watch.
It is video that is difficult to watch and has not been seen publicly until now. A Medina County Sheriff's deputy capturing on camera the shooting of a teenager in the eye at close range with a high propulsion pepper spray gun.
I'm gonna hit him now.
Hey, why'd you?
Deputy that you see there was convicted of felony assault. Prosecutors say the teen has traumatic and permanent injuries to his eye. KSAT investigates Dylan Collier explores what led to that fateful encounter.
It's June 19th, 2023, after 10 p.m., as Medina County Sheriff's Deputy Jonathan Nunemaker pulls over a BMW along Highway 90 in Castroville.
Hey, shut it off! Shut it off! Stick your hands out the window, now!
The man taken into custody.
Do not move.
What am I arrested for?
I didn't say you're under arrest.
Will later be identified as 17-year-old Branden Sanchez. The vehicle was stolen from a robbery at gunpoint in San Antonio just 4 hours earlier and contained a large quantity of drugs, a pellet gun resembling an AR-style rifle, and Sanchez's girlfriend, who is a minor. What transpired in this gas station parking lot over the next hour will change the course of the lives of the suspect and deputy forever. Body camera footage recorded by a Castroville Police Department officer shows Nunemaker becoming more and more agitated.
Kick my door again, you're gonna get hemmed up.
I didn't kick your door.
Sit there and shut up.
The deputy's attempts to inventory what's inside the stolen car interrupted time and again by Sanchez, who demands to know when he'll be taken to jail.
Okay, so as you can see, the teenager is in the back of the patrol car. He is actually kicking the door, but as the report indicates, they sat him in a gas station parking lot. He's under 18. He's 17 years old. He's in a gas station parking lot. Now, we don't have any information as to whether or not they contacted his parents or whatever, but why are they keeping him there for an hour? What is the point of having somebody sit in the gas station parking lot when you've got multiple units on scene, multiple people that you could be taking, somebody could be transporting him while somebody else works the scene? There's really no legitimate reason why you would have to have somebody handcuffed in the back of a police car in that tight space for an hour when you have other resources available to you to be able to transport him to the station where his parents could come take custody of him or whatever's going to happen. But there's really no reason for him to be sitting there. So I get it. He's being a jerk. He's kicking the car. But he's not really posing any sort of a threat. And so if you're going to use force on a handcuffed suspect, you know, you have to be thinking about the objective reasonableness of the force that you use in proportion to the threat being proffered at the time by the suspect. And so, what's the threat? My question is, what is the threat? And there's no mention, and again, it's an edited video from a news station, so it's possible the officer could have been concerned that he was going to harm himself or something, but he's not like slamming his face against the window. He's not doing anything that would harm him. Although it wouldn't matter because what is done to him as a result of what he's doing would certainly be antithetical to any sort of protective measures that you would expect a police officer to take. But essentially all he's doing is he's pissing off the police. And this is a 100% contempt of cop response to what he's doing. So the question really is, how could you even measure this in a way that would make it look reasonable to use any force? What exactly, what is the threat? What is he going to do that's going to cause such substantial issues for the police in that moment that couldn't be resolved by just driving him to the station instead of making him sit in the parking lot in the back of a tight police cruiser for an hour. You got to keep in mind that the crime happened somewhere else. It's not like there's a crime scene to be investigated here. The crime was for a robbery 4 hours away. It's more than likely like, you need to take me to the station. Oh, well, you don't tell me what to do. I'll do what I want to do and we'll sit here all night if we have to. That's probably what it's more about than it is them actually needing to have the suspect at the scene. If their purpose for keeping him at the scene for an hour was to notify the victim of the previous robbery and have that person come and do a lineup, that could have been done at the station. There's no reason why that needed to be done at the time. So if the vehicle is reported stolen, you may not have probable cause to charge the young man with the robbery that was the predicate for the stolen vehicle, but you do have probable cause that he's in a vehicle that is reported stolen. So he's at least, at a minimum, in possession of stolen property. You've got an NCIC hit. You can make a legitimate arrest based only on his presence in that vehicle and take him to the station for processing. And so it really boils down to them just wanting to sit in the parking lot, probably. And so we're going to take a look and see, as this starts to escalate, what exactly is the issue and what the officer does in response to him being agitated and kicking the seat. Let's watch some more.
Is he seriously doing... I'm going to hit him. Can you hang on for a second? Ted, I'm going to hit him. I'm done with this.
Nunemaker at one point retrieves leg shackles from his vehicle, but fails to put them on Sanchez, who continues to cause a commotion.
Watch out!
Flex, mother... I dare you.
Bro, chill out, bro. You just hit the out of my head.
After the seventh interruption, Nunemaker pulls out his department-issued pepper spray gun.
What the
And fires it into the handcuff Sanchez's eye from about 3.5 feet away. The teen screams in pain, unable to wipe his face, as Nunemaker calls for paramedics, telling a deputy supervisor minutes later.
Is he chill now? I don't know. I haven't heard him kicking my windows. Well, you know, it's a great equalizer, isn't it?
The distance from which the shot was placed was definitely way too close.
Chris Heitman is sheriff of Marys County, Missouri, and runs the Less Lethal Instructor Program for deputies statewide there.
You know, I can agree with a certain level of force, but that level arose way too high with that type of deployment, with that type of percussion weapon.
Other law enforcement in Medina County agreed. Castroville police at the scene notified their chain of command. Medina County Sheriff's Office leadership was then informed, and the case was handed over to the Texas Rangers. Less than a month after this incident, Nunemaker was indicted by a grand jury. Investigators determined the pepper spray had been discharged from the weapon at a speed of over 400 miles per hour. The solution, measuring at 4 million Scoville units, nearly twice as pungent as the chip from the infamous one-chip challenge. At trial in May, it took the jury less than an hour of deliberations to convict Nunemaker on both counts of aggravated assault by a public servant. He was given 7 years probation and is no longer eligible to maintain a peace officer's license.
A lot of it was emotion. The officer was acting on emotion. You could tell he was getting extremely frustrated by the video, and he acted out of emotion rather than the training he was probably provided.
See, all that pain is by yourself. Lots of poor choices tonight.
For KSAT Investigates,
walk this way.
I'm Dylan Collier.
Medina County prosecutors said Sanchez's permanent injuries to his left eye, including blindness that is unlikely to ever resolve. Sanchez confirmed this in a phone call with KSAT this week, telling us he is planning to have surgery to hopefully regain some of his vision. He's currently serving 6 years deferred adjudication in the San Antonio robbery case.
If that doesn't bother you, I mean, this kid is completely defenseless. I don't care what he did. I don't care if he just killed somebody. It doesn't matter. You have the duty to deal with the person who's under arrest constitutionally and preserve their constitutional rights. He's defenseless. His hands are behind his back. If you absolutely were going to shoot him with the pepper spray gun, it could have been fired in this region. And it would have had the same effect. If you were going to spray somebody with pepper spray, I promise you, I've been sprayed. I'm light-skinned. It lasts for 40 freaking minutes. And then when you take a shower, like an hour later, it reactivates as if you've been sprayed all over again. It's the worst. And I promise you that they could have shot him in the chest. They could have shot him in the torso. Shooting him was unreasonable anyway. We're going to look at the gram factors in a second. But even shooting him was unreasonable force. But I guarantee you that if they had shot him in somewhere in his, like, center mass, the pepper spray would have still gotten in his eyes or gotten in his airways, and it would have done what it's supposed to do. And you wouldn't have this extensive injury that has changed this kid's life forever. Now, again, I don't care what he did. He's a kid. He's 17 years old. Yeah, he might be a thug. Yeah, he might have robbed somebody. We don't know the whole story. A lot of times a robbery or a car theft, as it's called in by the alleged victim, is because I didn't have any money and I loaned my car to a drug dealer because I needed dope. So I let the drug dealer borrow my car for 2 hours. And then when they didn't bring it back, I reported it stolen. Well, that's not a stolen vehicle. That's a breach of trust or joyriding at best, or a civil matter, and you loaned your car out for heroin and that was your problem. That's how we get there. So the idea that this was actually a robbery, that we don't know. We just don't know. Now, the story did say that Sanchez was serving a deferred sentence for 6 years, which generally a deferred prosecution is, or a diversion is sometimes what it's called. It's where it's basically like, we're going to hang this over your head and you're going to do these things for 6 years in this case. And if you do these things, we're going to erase this conviction from your record. So it's kind of like a get out of jail free card. And so basically what happens is you basically jump through the hoops and you have a probation officer, the same as if you'd been convicted just straight up. But then once you finish your probation and you do all the things you said you would do for that period of 6 years, the arrest comes off your record and your record is expunged. That's generally what a deferred adjudication is, or a diversion is what it's called in some states. But here's the thing. Many people, mostly it's people who have drug problems, violate their probation during their deferred adjudication or their diversion period, and they get that diversion revoked and they end up with a conviction. And a lot of times people will have their probation altogether revoked and they get remanded to the penitentiary to serve their sentence. And what's crazy here is that this kid has extensive medical injuries. And if ever he gets into a situation where he can't meet the rules of probation, the cost of taking care of his medical needs as a result of what this officer did is going to fall on the taxpayers for the state of Texas. Because while he's in the Texas Department of Correction for the service of his sentence, they are responsible, the state of Texas and the taxpayers of the state of Texas are responsible for meeting his medical needs. And so if he ever has to serve that sentence, that 6 years, that's more money on top of the lawsuit that's going to be paid out, that has to be paid out. We had a guy in our county that is in there for homicide. There wasn't anything you could do. You couldn't get him out. I mean, he killed somebody in cold blood. It was a pretty much a slam dunk case. $1 million in a single year because he had some extensive medical needs. And so our county was out $1 million out of the jail's budget to pay for his medical needs. That money comes from the taxpayer's pocket. It doesn't come from the police. It comes from the taxpayer. And so what we're talking about here is a guy who could not control his ego or his temper and just decided to shoot this kid in the face at basically point blank range. And again, it's intentional. He could have aimed anywhere. He shot him in the eye on purpose. And as a result, the kid's blind probably for the rest of his life. And thankfully, and you know, this is something that we rarely see, but this happened a year ago, and this deputy has already been charged and convicted of 2 counts of aggravated assault by a police officer. And so now I do think it's quite an injustice that he got 7 years probation, because odds are, you know, he's going to make probation. At least he didn't get a deferred adjudication for whatever reason. So he's on probation, but he'll never see any jail time. I'd like to see the DOJ come in and charge him with a violation of federal law for deprivation of rights under color of law and actually see him do some prison time. 7 years probation is ridiculous for what he just did. There's no excuse for this, none whatsoever. We're going to brush over the Graham factors because they control in this situation, but there really isn't much of a point because it's obvious. It's on its face unreasonable. But the Graham factors are severity of the crime. Now, this is where you have some nuance. So number one is severity of crime. But you got to remember, it's not the severity of the crime that he's under arrest for. That was uneventful. That didn't have any use of force attached to that other than the show of force for the felony traffic stop. That's not what the Graham factor correlates to when we look at the severity of the crime. We're talking about the severity of what he's doing in the moment that force is applied. What he's doing in the moment that force is applied at best is like resisting or disorderly conduct or obstructing or something, whatever BS charge they have under Texas law to be able to hem somebody up on. But he's not doing anything. Vandalism maybe if he broke the back of the seat, but nothing major. There's no real threat. So as far as the severity of the crime, shooting a handcuffed person in the face with a high propulsion round of like a beanbag round or pepper spray or something like that is, there's just no argument to be made that it's reasonable. The second gram factor is whether the suspect posed an immediate threat to the safety of the officers or to himself. I mean, again, you hear nothing in the police officer's rhetoric or commentary that would suggest that he's concerned about him hurting himself. All he's concerned about is teaching him a lesson and being fed up with this kid kicking the back of his seat. He just flat out said, I'm sick of his crap, or I'm done with him, or whatever it was. But he'd had enough, right? So what is the actual threat? He's handcuffed. There is no threat whatsoever. If the officers are not engaging him or talking to him at all, he's no threat at all to anybody, except maybe himself if he's like doing something that might tangle him up in the seatbelt or might do something to harm him. There's nothing like that here. Nothing at all. So the first and second factors obviously lean towards unreasonableness. The third factor is whether the suspect was actively resisting or attempting to evade by flight. Well, I mean, you might make the argument that he was actively resisting, but what was he resisting? I mean, he's already under arrest. He's already secured. The only thing they might be able to do was like secure his feet so that he couldn't kick, but he's in custody. There's no thing that needs to be accomplished that can't be accomplished by simply driving him to the station. I mean, really what this boils down to is that this officer's ego has created layer and layer and layer of complications because he wouldn't take the kid to the station, and then he ultimately just gets fed up with his attitude and decides to hurt him on purpose. And it's real rich that he makes the comment at the end of the video, lots of bad decisions. Yeah, lots of bad decisions by the kid, but most importantly by you. You're the adult. You're the adult in the room. You're the one that's supposed to be trusted to make good decisions. This is a kid. So for the third gram factor, it's obvious that it leans in favor of unreasonable. So you can look at this on his face and tell it's unreasonable. There's nobody. That's why he's already been a year later charged and convicted of aggravated assault. This was such an easy case, impossible to defend on the use of force. This was an egregious assault against this kid, where he will have lifelong injuries that the county will be on the hook for paying because the lawsuit will easily settle. There's no reason to go to trial on this at all unless they just offer some measly amount and they want an actual big jury verdict, which they will get in this case, I predict. So this is a pretty easy one to call, honestly. In closing, I do think that I'm starting to see a little bit of a shift, and I don't know. I try to be an optimistic person. I don't know that for sure. But over the last couple months, there's been less and less bad police encounters to talk about. I found myself at times scrambling around for something to make a video about, quite honestly, that isn't like some boring like case law breakdown, because there haven't been that many encounters where it's like you've got like, you know, low-hanging fruit to choose from all the time. So there have been a couple times where I've had to make videos that are a couple years old, or I've seen other people with channels like mine, Civil Rights Lawyer and Lackluster and Audit the Audit, those guys making like some videos that are about situations that are a little bit dated, because there's been, in my estimation, a slowdown of these encounters, and I'm hopeful that that means that the tides are starting to turn. I'm going to do a video later in the week about Tennessee troopers getting sued over these false DUI claims. The people are getting fed up. And it's kind of funny. It's not funny, ha-ha. It's funny like it's kind of surprising. They don't have a problem with the police beating up the black people. They don't have a problem with the police going down there and kicking around people they consider to be thugs and gang members and all that stuff. When you start arresting suburban white people for DUI and you start imposing law enforcement efforts on the back the blue crowd, that's when you start to see holy cow, the whole back the blue till it happens to you thing is real. And I'm starting to see a little bit of shift in public opinion, I think, about police. So we'll see what happens there. Maybe when the lawsuit drops, I'm sure when the settlement comes out, this will be a big number. So whenever the settlement comes out, I'll probably offer an update on this. But I think this is a pretty easy one to analyze. There really isn't anything to be labeled as remotely reasonable here. There's a lot that bothers me about this case, but one of the things is, like, this kid probably would have went to prison for this crime had it not been for the way he was treated in the process of being arrested. So the deputy and his fragile ego has cost the taxpayers of this county probably millions of dollars in either medical expenses or a lawsuit. He's lost his career. He's now a convicted felon. He's actually no different. He's currently serving a longer sentence than the kid that he arrested. So just think about that. Let that land for a minute. This deputy got 7 years probation. So if he gets himself in trouble or he gets hemmed up, he's going to prison for 7 years. The kid got a deferred prosecution for a violent robbery at gunpoint with a fake AR-15, all because of the way this deputy treated him and the way that the arrest was conducted. Because it's really hard to get a guy to cooperate who's the victim to prosecute this officer when he's also the defendant in another case. So they really tied the prosecutor's hands, to put it mildly, in the prosecutor's ability to seek justice for the robbery victim, because now they had to worry about this police officer being a complete clown and doing something much more egregious to a pretrial detainee in the process of making an arrest. So it just goes to show you the kind of damage that can be done when you hire the wrong people and give them a badge and the authority and the weight of the state in order to enforce their arbitrary rules that govern their fragile ego on the population of people who pay their salaries. So anyway, that's all I have for this one, guys. Thanks for sticking it out. Please remember to like and subscribe and leave a comment on the video. Check out some of the other videos on the channel and leave a comment on there as well. Until I see you again, take care. Always film your interactions with the police and keep your evidence to yourself.